Dear students, good afternoon. So in this class, I'll be explaining about colorimetry. So the aim of this colorimetry is to estimate the amount of copper in copper sulfate solution. Okay. So what is the title of the experiment? Estimation of copper in given copper sulfate solution by colorimetric method. The method which is simply called as colorimetry. Okay. Let's see what is this colorimetry, and colorimetry is based on which law. So colorimetry, so it is a method which is applicable for colored solution. Color plus metry, it is a method which is applicable for colored solution. Therefore this method is called as colorimetry. So what is the principle involved in colorimetry? So in colorimetric method, we measure the amount of light absorbed by the colored solution in order to estimate the amount of the substance present in the analyte. Okay, so what is colorimetry? It is the quantitative determination of the analyte sample by measuring the amount of light absorbed by the colored solution. Okay, so what is colorimetry? Colorimetry is a quantitative method in which the quantity of the substance is determined by measuring the amount of light absorbed by the colored solution. And colorimetry is based on a combined law known as Beer's and Lambert's law. So colorimetry is based on which law? Beer's and Lambert's law, called as Beer's Lambert's law. Then what this Beer's Lambert's law states? So Beer's Lambert's law states that the absorbance of light by the colored solution is directly proportional to concentration and path length. So what Beer's Lambert's law states? It states that the absorbance of light by the colored solution is directly proportional to the concentration of the solution and the path length. Okay, so let's see what is the phenomenon involved in colorimetric method. Okay, so let me consider a transparent medium that consists of colored solution of concentration C. Okay. So transparent medium that consists of colored solution of concentration C. C stands for concentration. And the path length of the medium is taken as T. Okay. So what is path length? Path length is the thickness of the medium, or it is the total distance traveled by the light through the medium, or it is the distance between the two ends of the medium, or the distance between the two sides of the medium. Okay. So C stands for concentration and T stands for path length. So what is path length? It is the total distance traveled by the light through the medium, or it is the thickness of the medium. So what this medium consists of? A colored solution of concentration C. So when a monochromatic light of intensity I naught, what is monochromatic light? A light of single wavelength. Okay. When a monochromatic light of intensity I naught is made to fall on a transparent medium, so three phenomena occurs. The amount of light may get absorbed, amount of light may get transmitted, or amount of light may get reflected. Okay, so three phenomena occurs when a light is made to fall on a transparent medium that consists of a colored solution of concentration C with the path length of the medium T. So light may get absorbed, light may get transmitted, light may get reflected. Therefore, the intensity of incident light I naught is equal to IA plus IT plus IR. Since it is a transparent medium, that is for glass-air interface, the amount of reflected light is negligibly small. So this can be considered as zero. Arbitrarily, it can be considered as zero, because for transparent medium or for glass-air interface, the amount of light reflected is less. So it can be neglected. So what it indicates, I naught will be equivalent to the amount of light absorbed or the amount of light transmitted. So the amount of light absorbed or the amount of light transmitted depends upon two factors, which are those, of course, concentration and path length. So the amount of light absorbed depends upon concentration and path length, as stated by Beer's Lambert's law. Okay, so let's see what is this Beer's Lambert's law. So Beer's law states that the intensity of monochromatic light I naught decreases exponentially as the concentration of the solution increases arithmetically. Okay, what Beer's law states? the intensity of incident light I naught decreases exponentially as the concentration of the solution increases arithmetically. Or in simple words, Beer's law states that absorbance is directly proportional to concentration. Okay, what Beer's law states? Absorbance is directly proportional to concentration. Then what about Lambert's law? So Lambert's law states that the intensity of monochromatic light I naught decreases exponentially, okay, with increase in path length of the medium arithmetically. Okay, or in other words, Lambert's law states that absorbance is directly proportional to path length. That means the absorbance of light by the colored solution depends upon both concentration and path length according to Beer's and Lambert's law. So how absorbance is related to concentration? Directly proportional according to Beer's law. And how absorbance is related to path length according to Lambert's law? They are directly proportional. Okay. Therefore, absorbance, which is equal to log of I naught by IT, which is equal to epsilon CT. Okay. So what is absorbance? Absorbance is logarithmic ratio of intensity of incident light to that of intensity of transmitted light is equal to epsilon CT according to Beer's Lambert's law, where epsilon is molar absorption coefficient. So epsilon is a proportionality constant known as molar absorption coefficient. C is the concentration and T is path length. So it is evident from this equation that absorbance depends on concentration as well as path length. So when path length is kept constant, absorbance is totally dependent on concentration. Okay. It's possible to keep this path length constant. So when we keep this path length constant, anyhow, epsilon is constant because it is a proportionality constant. So C is variable, T is also variable. But when T is kept constant, so absorbance is totally dependent on concentration. So what it states in general, absorbance is proportional to concentration when path length is constant. Then how this path length becomes constant? Use the same medium throughout the experiment. Okay. So when same medium is used for different concentration of the solution, T becomes constant. So by varying concentration, absorbance varies. Okay. But here, the amount of light absorbed also depends upon the amount of light transmitted, because when light is made to fall on a transparent medium, light may get absorbed or light may get transmitted. So let me see what is this transmittance and how transmittance is related to absorbance. So transmittance in general is defined as the ratio of transmitted light to that of incident light. What is transmittance? It is the amount of light transmitted, which is defined as the ratio of light transmitted to that of light incident. So what is absorbance? It is logarithmic ratio of intensity of incident light to that of intensity of transmitted light. Therefore, absorbance will be equal to log of 1 by T. Okay. So absorbance is equal to log 1 by T. Okay. Where caps T is the transmittance. Don't get confused here. Capital T is the transmittance, whereas small t is the path length. So therefore, if T is taken to the numerator, absorbance becomes equal to minus log T. So what is the relation between absorbance and transmittance? They are inversely proportional. So when absorbance is maximum, transmittance is minimum and vice versa, where T is transmittance in percentage. Okay, always T is expressed in percentage. So what is the relation between absorbance and transmittance? They are inversely proportional. So what we can say in general, as concentration increases, absorbance increases, because absorbance is directly proportional to concentration, but transmittance decreases. Okay, so this is the relation between absorbance, transmittance and concentration when path length is constant. Okay, so this is the principle which is involved in colorimetric method. So colorimetric method is based on which law? Beer's and Lambert's law. So what Beer's and Lambert's law states? Beer's and Lambert's law states that the amount of light absorbed by the colored solution is directly proportional to concentration and path length. When path length is kept constant, absorbance is directly proportional to concentration. Okay, absorbance is directly proportional to concentration, but transmittance is inversely proportional to concentration. Okay, so this is the principle of colorimetric method. Now let me discuss how to estimate copper by using colorimetric method. So we go through the procedure. Okay, see here, there are three parts of the procedure. So the first part of the procedure is preparation of series of standard solutions. Okay, so first you need to prepare a series of standard solutions followed by calibration of the instrument and then measuring of absorbance. Okay, so what are the three parts of the procedure? Preparation of series of standard copper sulfate solutions. Second, calibrating the instrument. Third, measuring the absorbance. So in the preparation of standard copper sulfate solutions, you will be given 6 standard flasks of 100 ml volume. So as I have shown here, so you are supposed to take 600 ml standard flask. And these flasks are labeled as B and U and numbered as 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, for your reference. So two flasks are labeled as B and U. And remaining four flasks are numbered as 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, for your reference. So B stands for blank solution. U stands for unknown solution. And 1, 2, 3, 4 stands for the flask in which you are going to take a known volume of copper sulfate solution. Okay, so B blank solution, U unknown solution. Whereas in 1, 2, 3, 4 standard flask, you are going to take a known volume of copper sulfate solution. Okay, so let me see how to prepare a series of copper sulfate solutions. So starting from blank solution. So B stands for blank solution. So blank solution means it is the solution which is prepared without taking test solution. Which is the test solution in this experiment? It is the copper sulfate. So you will be given copper sulfate solution in which you are required to estimate the amount of copper. So in this experiment, blank solution is the solution which is prepared without taking copper sulfate solution. Let's see, without taking copper sulfate solution, how this blank solution is prepared. You take 5 cc of ammonia accurately. Okay, you take 5 cc of ammonia which is added into the flask, followed by the addition of DI water up to the mark. Okay, I hope you remember how to prepare a standard solution. So in the B labeled standard flask, you should not take copper sulfate solution, but you should take accurately 5 cc of ammonia and add DI water up to the mark. Okay, then take one numbered flask. Now what should be taken in 1, 2, 3, 4? A known volume of copper sulfate solution. So in one numbered flask, a known volume of 5 cc of copper sulfate solution should be taken. Okay, a known volume of 5 cc of copper sulfate solution should be taken, to which you should add accurately 5 cc of ammonia and remaining DI water up to the mark. Then take second numbered flask. Now you increase the volume of copper sulfate. So in the second numbered flask, what is the volume of copper sulfate to be taken? 10 cc. For 10 cc copper sulfate solution, you should add 5 cc of ammonia accurately, then keep adding DI water up to the mark. Then take three numbered flask, take 15 cc of copper sulfate, add 5 cc of ammonia and DI water up to the mark. Then take four numbered flask. Now what's the volume of copper sulfate to be added? 20 cc of copper sulfate, add 5 cc of ammonia accurately, then add DI water up to the mark. Then you will be given UX. What UX stands for? Unknown, right? So here you are not supposed to take copper sulfate solution. You will be given X cc of copper sulfate solution, which is unknown to you. Okay, so this will be given by the examiner. So you will be given X cc of copper sulfate solution by the examiner, to which you should add accurately 5 cc of ammonia and add DI water up to the mark. Okay, after making the solution up to the mark in all the flasks, put the lid and mix it well for uniform concentration. Okay, so this is how you are supposed to prepare a series of copper sulfate solution by taking a known volume of copper sulfate solution in an increment of 5 cc, 10 cc, 15 cc, 20 cc in 1, 2, 3, 4 standard flask. But remember, you should not take copper sulfate in blank as well as in unknown. Because in blank, no copper sulfate solution is added. In unknown, so you will be given copper sulfate solution of unknown volume. Okay, but remember here, you should add accurately 5 cc of ammonia to all the 6 flasks accurately. Okay, then add DI water up to the mark considering lower meniscus in all the 6 flasks. After adding water up to the mark, put the stopper and mix it well in order to get uniform concentration of the solution. Okay. Now, why we are supposed to add ammonia? Okay. So as I mentioned, you should add 5 cc of ammonia to all the 6 flasks. Okay. So this ammonia is used as a coloring agent. Okay. So for your reference, I have shown a color change here. Okay. I have shown a color change here. I'll come back to this later. So let me see why this ammonia is added. So ammonia is used as a coloring agent, which is used to develop a color to the solution. This is why, because our copper sulfate solution is light blue in color. Okay. But when this copper sulfate is treated with ammonia, ammonia converts the copper sulfate into cupromonium complex. Okay. So copper sulfate gets converted to cupromonium complex when treated with ammonia, which is a deep blue colored complex. So ammonia is added to intensify the color of the solution. Okay. Because this method is based on Beer-Lambert's law, which holds good for highly colored solution. Okay. So when you intensify the solution color, so more accurate result can be obtained. Therefore, we add ammonia. Okay. So what is the purpose of adding ammonia? It is used as a coloring agent to develop a deep blue color, because copper sulfate reacts with ammonia and gets converted into cupromonium complex, which is deep blue in color. Okay. So what is the color of the blank solution then? Since we have not taken copper sulfate in blank solution, the blank solution is colorless. Okay. But when you take copper sulfate in an increment of 5, 10, 15, 20 cc, the concentration of copper ions in the solutions increases. So when this copper sulfate is treated with ammonia, what happens to the intensity of the color? It increases. So when you consider first number standard flask, it is found to be somewhat light blue. Okay. But when compared to second number flask, it is quite more blue than the first. Similarly, third flask solution is even more blue than second number flask. And also the fourth number solution will be more dark, okay, when compared to 1, 2, 3. And when it comes to unknown, so depending upon the volume of copper sulfate solution given, so it exhibits its own blue color. Okay. So here you cannot say it will be greater than this. So it depends upon the concentration of copper sulfate, which is given to you. Okay. So this is how the color change has to be observed. Okay. Color change has to be observed. Now, what is blank solution? Now I'll come to this point. What is blank solution and why this blank solution is prepared? So what is blank solution? It is a solution which is prepared without taking test solution. And this blank solution is colorless. So the purpose of preparing this blank solution is to calibrate the instrument. We need to calibrate the instrument using this blank solution. Hope you have understood how to prepare a series of standard solutions. Okay. By taking known volume of copper sulfate in 1, 2, 3, 4. And also you should prepare blank solution by taking 5 cc of ammonia and DI water. And unknown solution, you will be given unknown volume of copper sulfate to which you should add 5 cc of ammonia and water. Now, using the solutions, you are supposed to measure the absorbance of all these solutions one by one after you calibrate the instrument using blank solution. Okay. Yeah, now let me see how to perform an experiment. As I already mentioned, there are three parts of the procedure. First part, preparation of standard solutions. Second part, calibration. Let's see how to calibrate the instrument. So this is the instrument, okay, which is used in colorimetric method. And the name of the instrument is photoelectric colorimeter. Okay, so photoelectric colorimeter is a digital spectrophotometer which measures light in the visible region. Okay, it measures the light in the visible region in the wavelength range of 400 to 700 nanometer. Okay, so this is a photoelectric colorimeter. So this is what we call it as test tubes, or what you can call it as cuvette. Okay. So this is the medium what we use, a test tube, a transparent test tube, or what we call it as a cuvette, a cylindrical tube. Okay. And here you can observe, this is the display unit. Okay. And this is the region where we keep the sample. Okay. So this is the region where we keep the sample. And these two are the knobs. So this knob is set 0 knob, and this knob is set 100 knob. And can you see a component here? So this is what we call it as a filter. Okay, so this is photoelectric colorimeter. This is the region where we keep the sample to measure the absorbance. This is filter. Okay, and this is display unit. This is set 0 now. This is set 100 now. This is the switch to change the mode to absorbance and transmittance. Okay, so this is the switch, okay, through which you can change the mode. Okay, while taking the reading, while calibrating, you can change the mode to transmittance. While taking the reading, you can change the mode to absorbance. Okay, and this is the test tube, transparent medium in which we take the sample. Let's see how to calibrate the instrument. The first part of the calibration is choosing a filter. So this is filter, what I told you. This is the knob, what you can see is a filter, or what we call it as a monochromator. Okay. What is the role of this filter? So filter, it filters all other lights and allows only a specific light of particular wavelength, because specific ions absorbs light of specific wavelength. So here you have to fix one wavelength at which copper shows maximum absorbance. So what is filter? Filter is a monochromator which allows light of single wavelength to pass through the sample. So in the estimation of copper, filter number 7 is used. Okay, we use a filter number 7 to fix a wavelength of 620 nanometer. Okay, what is the filter number used? If you rotate this knob, you can see different filter numbers. But in the estimation of copper, filter number 7 is used to set a wavelength of 620 nanometer. This 620 nanometer is taken as lambda max. What do you mean by lambda max? It is the wavelength at which copper absorbs maximum. Okay, so what is the lambda max for copper? It is 620 nanometer. And the second step of the calibration is blank solution. Okay, now what you have to do, take this test tube. Okay, fill this 3/4 of the test tube with this blank solution. Keep this blank solution in this region. Now while calibrating the instrument, change the mode to transmittance. Okay, here you can see this is transmittance, this is absorbance here. If you see these two, okay, this is the transmittance mode, this is the absorbance mode. If you change the switch, it changes to transmittance mode. Keeping in transmittance mode, we have to calibrate the instrument using blank solution. After you change the mode to transmittance, keep the blank solution in this region, okay, and using set 100 knob, set the transmittance to 100. Okay, as I already told you, this is set 0 knob. Don't touch the set 0 knob, just touch the set 100 knob. So what you can do, keep the mode in transmittance, keep the blank solution in the colorimeter, set its transmittance 100%. Okay, so when transmittance becomes 100%, what will be the absorbance? Absorbance, that is optical density, it becomes 0. Now using blank solution, set transmittance to 100%. Okay, keeping the mode in transmittance. After transmittance is set to 100, change the mode to absorbance. When the mode changes to absorbance, what will be the value that should be displayed? 0. What it indicates, when transmittance is at 100%, optical density of the blank solution becomes 0. So this is how we have to calibrate the instrument. See, follow the third point what I have written. Keep mode in transmittance while calibrating the instrument using blank solution. Remember, keep mode in transmittance while calibrating the instrument using blank solution. After the instrument is calibrated, keep the mode in absorbance while measuring the absorbance of the solutions. That's it. So while calibrating the instrument, remember these four steps. Now the question is, why it is required to calibrate the instrument using blank solution? So using blank solution, we set its transmittance 100% to make its optical density 0. Clear? So theoretically, what we can say, absorbance of blank solution is 0 because blank solution is colorless. Clear? So blank solution is colorless. So theoretically we say absorbance of blank solution is 0. But practically there may be a chance of some absorbance due to the presence of coloring impurity ammonia, right? See, blank solution consists of ammonia and water without taking copper sulfur solution. And we have taken 5 cc of ammonia and water in all the flask. See, ammonia, we use it as a coloring agent, but it itself acts as a coloring impurity. Okay, ammonia itself acts as a coloring impurity. So being a coloring impurity, ammonia may also show absorbance. So if you measure the absorbance of all these solutions, you're measuring the absorbance of the overall solution, not copper sulfate, right? But we need to measure the absorbance of only copper ions in order to estimate its concentration. Therefore, the absorbance effect of ammonia should be nullified. Okay? The absorbance effect of ammonia should be nullified. Therefore, we prepare blank solution and we make its transmittance 100% so that its optical density becomes zero. Therefore, the absorbance of ammonia in the rest of the solution will get nullified. Okay? The absorbance of ammonia in the rest of the solution will get nullified when the instrument is calibrated using blank solution so that you can measure the absorbance of copper ions accurately. Okay, so this is how you have to do the calibration part. Once the instrument is calibrated, okay, switch the mode to absorbance. Keep these solutions one by one in the colorimeter and measure its corresponding absorbance. So for example, as I have shown in the tabular column, for blank there is no absorbance. For 5, 10, 15, 20, as well as for unknown, measure the corresponding absorbance using photoelectric colorimeter. So roughly I have given you values. So maybe for 5 cc it is 0.05, for 10 cc 0.10, for 15 0.15, for 20 cc 0.0. So we may not know the concentration of the copper sulfate in test solution, but we can measure its absorbance. That may be around 0.11, okay, in this case, for example. Now what we should know how much volume of copper sulfate is given in the unknown. Okay, that X value we should find out because we don't know what is the XCC of copper sulfate given in the test solution. This we need to find out. So we need to plot a graph. Okay, and this graph is called as calibration graph. So how this graph is plotted? Take volume of copper sulfate along X-axis, that is volume of copper sulfate of known volume along X-axis. And the corresponding absorbance, what we have measured along y-axis. So known volume of copper sulfate means you have taken 5, 10, 15, 20. Therefore, you should get 4 points on your graph. Okay. Now, what you have to do? Select maximum points. See, if you do the experiment properly, you are able to join all the 4 points. If there is anything that goes wrong while calibrating, so it is not possible to join all 4 points. So in that case, what you have to do? Select maximum points. Minimum 3 points you should consider. Minimum 3 points. Okay, so maximum 4 points, minimum 3 points you should consider. Then keep the scale passing through origin, select maximum points and draw a straight line. Okay, remember here it is a linear graph that gives you straight line, and that straight line should compulsory pass through origin. Okay, it should compulsory pass through origin. Okay, so why it gives a linear graph? Because absorbance increases linearly with increase in concentration. And why the straight line should pass through origin? Because when concentration is zero, absorbance is zero. And this calibration graph is obtained by calibrating the instrument using blank solution. And for blank solution, what is the absorbance we made? Zero. Okay. Now after getting a straight line in the graph, so extrapolate the graph from the absorbance of unknown concentration. So what is the absorbance measured for unknown concentration? For example, 0.11. So 0.11, that is on y-axis, extrapolate the graph and extend it up to x-axis. What are the values taken on x-axis? Volume of copper sulfate. So the point on x-axis corresponding to that absorbance which is measured for unknown gives you XCC. Okay. Now what is XCC? It is the volume of copper sulfate which is given in unknown solution. Okay, this is how you need to find out the XCC of copper sulfate which is given in the unknown sample by plotting a calibration graph. Okay, now after finding XCC, then we have to do a calculation. So calculation I have shown here. First, we need to find out weight of copper sulfate in milligram. Okay, as shown in the third column. And then we need to measure or we need to estimate the weight of copper in all of the solutions what we have prepared. So to find out the weight of copper sulfate in milligram, refer this conversion factor. What this conversion factor says, 1000 cc of copper sulfate solution is equivalent to 5 gram of copper sulfate. Therefore, 1 cc of copper sulfate solution is equivalent to 5 milligram of copper sulfate. If 1 cc of copper sulfate is equivalent to 5 milligram, find out in 5 cc how much. Simple cross multiplication, 5 into 5, 25 milligram. So in 10 cc it is 50 milligram, in 15 cc it is 75 milligram, and in 20 cc it is 100 milligram. Therefore, in x cc how much it will be? It is 5 into x volume. X volume, that is from the graph. Find out x milligram of copper sulfate which is present in x cc of copper sulfate solution. Okay, so this, whatever the values you are going to get through this calculation should be entered in the third row. Okay, then what we need to find out, weight of copper in milligram in each of the solutions. For this, refer the second conversion factor, that is 249.68 gram of copper sulfate is equivalent to 63.54 gram of copper, where 249 is molecular weight of copper sulfate, 63.54 is equivalent weight of copper. If this much consists of this much, so what is the weight of copper sulfate in 5 cc? So weight of copper sulfate in 5 cc is 25 milligram. So find out in 25 milligram of copper sulfate, how much amount of copper is present. Again, simple cross multiplication, 25 milligram into 63.54 divided by 249.68. So what is the approximate weight of copper present here? 6.36 milligram of copper. So 6.36 milligram of copper is present in 25 milligram of copper sulfate, which is present in 5 cc of copper sulfate solution. Okay, in a same fashion, you should find out the weight of copper in all the solutions what you have prepared along with the unknown. Okay, and then you are required to write two results. So what are the two results you should write? From the graph, the volume of copper sulfate in the test solution is x cc, that is this x value, and the weight of copper in the given test solution is x milligram. So that is the final value what you are going to find out here. The x milligram of copper, which is present in x milligram of copper sulfate, which is present in x cc of copper sulfate solution. Okay, so this is how you are supposed to calculate the weight of copper sulfate in milligram and weight of copper in milligram through this calculations, and the corresponding values what you are going to get should be entered in this tabular column. Okay, so this is a procedure to estimate copper in copper sulfate by colorimetric method.